DeepSeek, a threat or a boon? Now, we have seen a lot of disruption in the market. There was about $1 trillion of market cap lost on the stock exchange. There has been debate among major venture capital firms whether they have overinvested in AI infrastructure. And of course, there's this conversation whether we are moving from so-called phase one to phase two of AI. The phase one being the infrastructure of AI, and phase two being products and applications. Now, these are serious shifts we're talking about just because a small company in China called DeepSeek launched a model that looks like it's as good as ChatGPT and some others that you may be using. Now, what did DeepSeek achieve? Their performance, their cost, their benchmarks are quite impressive. First of all, in terms of performance, they have shown that you can train these large language models with chips that are 6 times less powerful than the latest chips used by some top companies in the US. And they have shown that can achieve this also at a very reduced cost. Often, the API calls that cost us about $1 for 5,000 queries are now down by a factor of 30. And they're achieving all of this while beating the benchmarks from the top companies. Only OpenAI and Google are slightly ahead. So this is quite surprising. So how did they achieve this? The first technique is called mixture of experts. It's as if you're a CEO of a company, and then you have some really smart people, some in a particular organization. You ask different one of them to see what are their opinions, and then you use a mixture of those opinions. And by doing this, you may not be subjecting your whole organization to a given task, but only using a subset of the task. So while traditional large language models might use a 600 billion parameter model, the DeepSeek has shown with this mixture of expert approach that maybe you need only about 1/20th, maybe about 30 billion or so parameters, so much smaller part. Now, this is an idea that has been used by many companies in the past, most famously by a company called Mistral in France. But they have shown some improvements, but DeepSeek has really achieved the best performance. The second one is called reinforcement learning, which is a trial and error method, as opposed to what most other companies use right now, which is called SFT, or supervised fine tuning. One would argue that if I have to teach a dog how to be better, it's probably better to show the dog with some examples, saying this is how you catch the frisbee, this is how you jump, and so on. And that's basically supervised fine-tuning, as opposed to reinforcement learning, which is a trial and error method. You let the dog do certain things, and if the dog does well, you give a treat. And if the dog doesn't do well, you don't give a treat. So-called rewards in machine learning terminology. So one would argue that a supervised fine-tuning is a much better method than reinforcement learning, which is a trial and error method. But surprise, DeepSeek showed that using a RL method, a reinforcement learning method, actually achieves better performance. The third one is reasoning. Again, this is not new. The idea is that, again, if you are working with a company, would you rather have a company that is one amazing, brilliant CEO and you get a service from that? Or would you work with a company where the CEO runs a really nice organization and the CEO can take that main task and give it to his or her subordinates and then talk among themselves, they figure it out, and they come back with a good service. Now, most of us would prefer the second approach, which is there's some reasoning, some thinking, some planning goes in the organization and then the service for our request. So this idea actually has been the core of some of the progress that OpenAI has made. So if you remember, there was a ChatGPT 3.5, ChatGPT 4, and so on. But over the last year, many of these companies have switched to so-called reasoning models. And they call it the O1 series of models from OpenAI and ChatGPT. So this trend has already been going on. But DeepSeek just took that to the next level, and they have shown that focusing more on reasoning, they can achieve really good performances. So that's why they call their model R1. Actually, they have two models, R0 and R1, and they showed that R0 was just using reinforcement learning, So it was performing well, but often it would create garbage and maybe think too creatively. And in the R1 model, they showed that with some tuning, it can actually provide great results. And they have done all of that just in the last 3 months or so, which is very exciting. Again, all these techniques, mixture of experts, reinforcement learning, reasoning, have been well explored by existing companies, but DeepSeek just managed to put them together in a very clever way. And finally, efficiency. I think this is really, really where DeepSeek shines. The argument is that in the US, we have plenty of chips, plenty of compute, of course, plenty of funding, and there has been very little reason to find the most efficient ways to make machine learning work. But given a Chinese company that's under embargo of chips and some form of talent, they really had to figure out how do you make this work in a very, very efficient way. So in terms of efficiency, what they have shown is you can actually take your CUDA call, which is a high-level library used by NVIDIA, and go lower and lower, closer to so-called assembly-style code, and make it very, very compact. And this is very similar to how, during the space race, the Russian scientists and engineers figured out how to write the code that's extremely efficient. And some would argue that even today, Silicon Valley and a lot of tech companies prefer Russian talent because they have figured out how to write very, very efficient code because they lived under highly constrained computing infrastructure. The second one is cost reduction from all kinds of mechanisms. As I said, the Chinese company had access to only about 800 chips from NVIDIA, which are a couple of generations older than what everybody else has here in the US. But they were able to use it in a very efficient manner to develop this model. And because the model is so compact now, it can do magical things. So for example, instead of using so-called 32 bits to represent a floating point number, they're using only 8 bits. So that should remind you, you know, of the old kind of 8-bit JPEGs and so on that look very crummy and very pixelated. But actually, it turns out for machine learning, it's good enough to use this very low resolution. Now, it's an idea that others have explored in the US, but didn't really take it to the extreme. And finally, scaling loss. Now, scaling loss has become a kind of a mantra, almost like a law in the US. You might have heard about the Moore's law, where this assumption that the computing gets better and better, it doubles about roughly every 2 years. And the scaling law has also become a mantra where it says that if you simply increase compute or data or size of your model, then magically your machine learning models will get better. And this one simple belief in the scaling law has driven all the investments so far in the US. Just think about that. This one specific belief in scaling law has driven a lot of the innovation, a lot of the talent, and of course, the stock price of NVIDIA. Now, what these techniques like reinforcement learning instead of supervised fine training, techniques like reasoning as opposed to straight up serving of the models, these particular tweaks have shown that actually doing a so-called test time compute is better than training time compute. What does that mean? So the belief till some time ago was that you should just build this one massive model, which might have hundreds of billions of parameters, maybe trillion parameter. Each time you train it, it costs about $100 million, and you create a team of hundreds of people to build it. So that's the traditional way of thinking about it. The reasoning approach that OpenAI and DeepSeek are pushing says that actually, you know what? You can create a model that may not be the best, but you can reason with it. You can ask multiple questions if it doesn't get it right, or ask to break the problem down into smaller components. Let it think, let it plan. And then even if you don't have the best model, at runtime, actually it can do a pretty good job. And the analogy I gave you earlier about a single CEO being smart versus a CEO who knows how to distribute the task to his or her employees is a similar analogy here. But the reason we should really think about scaling law is now there is a sudden realization that maybe we do not have to care about the scaling laws. And instead of using brute force solutions, such as large compute, large data, and large models, we can be clever about it in software and achieve the same performance without those brute force investments. Now, this seems like such a small shift in the perspective, which is instead of brute force scaling, let's be clever in our algorithms and efficiency. But that's upending the financial structure. It's upending the investment structure, but more importantly, it's also affecting the geopolitical structure of AI. So what are these geopolitical implications? One is that this global competition of chips and talent and data certainly seems kind of overblown, because it seems like now any country, not just US or China, but anybody in a developing country can use models like DeepSeek and make rapid progress by using this approach of reasoning as opposed to brute force scaling laws. The second is this notion of access to hardware and these embargoes. We have been hearing a lot about companies like NVIDIA and ASME and so on have been told to decrease the power of their chips before they export. And this seems like a good idea, but what DeepSeek is showing to some extent is that, again, you don't need the highest end chips. All you need is very clever algorithms to be able to achieve somewhat similar results. So this is a little bit confusing for everybody who has thought about how AI is going to play out going forward. Now, this may be actually a good democratization of AI, where a startup in a small country that's working on a very important problem in health or climate, which was very dependent on a lot of talent and a lot of chips and a lot of data, now could be in the game and actually go and solve those problems that humanity really cares about. But at the same time, it feels like the democratization will also create a decentralization of the power of AI. So that's a lot of hope and a lot of hype about what a small company with algorithms can do in all these sectors. So let's make sure we also clarify some of the misconceptions. The first one is a lot of people are questioning, should you really trust what DeepSeek is saying? For example, they have made a claim that their cost is only about $6 million, as opposed to billions of dollars that are spent by US companies. Now, first of all, the CapEx, the cost of the chips and hardware, if you just take DeepSeek at its what they have said, which is about 800 chips, that alone comes to about $50 million in CapEx. And we're talking about just about chips, not everything else that goes around it. And although one run of it, which runs about 2 months, costs them about $6 million, that's not the only run. They probably had to run this many, many times before they got it absolutely right in the last few weeks. So if they had to maybe run 10 times before they got it right, instead of 6 million, maybe it's more like 60 million. And one would argue that, but even 60 million is cheaper than in the amount of money the US companies are spending. So the truth is somewhere in between. It cannot be $6 million, and it's not $1 billion, it's somewhere in between. The second misconception is that, hey, because this is a Chinese model, if we use DeepSeek solution, then all the data may potentially flow to China. This is not true. The interesting move that DeepSeek has gone after is they've actually made the model open source, which is different than Llama 3 from Meta, which is open weight. So it's possible for anybody to download the source code and the weights, as well as the paper that DeepSeek has written that very cleanly explains every step of the training and inference. And anybody can download that and create their own version. So platforms like Hugging Face or Perplexity, within 24 hours, have already created their own versions of DeepSeek that looks actually different from what DeepSeek has. And we all can use it without worrying about it. So for example, if you go to DeepSeek's chat and ask, you know, who's the prime minister of Taiwan, you will not get an answer. At the same time, if you ask that on Perplexity or Hugging Face model, you know, there's no problem with that at all. The third misconception is this a so-called Sputnik moment, which launched the space race? Of course, one would argue that even the Sputnik moment, although the concern was this would be a space war, created more of a space innovation movement, and it has played out actually beautifully well. We have benefited in so many ways with geospatial technologies. Countries like India have taken the space innovation and used it for completely peaceful purposes for their own population. And maybe the same thing is going to happen here, that although we're in this moment where it feels like it's an AI race between, let's say, US and China, in reality, this is going to create a lot of democratization. So three quick philosophical aspects to it. First is, does it mean open source is going to win? Maybe, because open source does allow faster innovation, but in the history of technological companies, what has usually happened is they start with open source to attract a lot of attention, but over time, they switch to closed source. So it's an open secret that open source is a good way to get attention, but eventually it'll move to a different business model, which is fine. The second one is, because of this model, are we getting any closer to AGI, the superintelligence, artificial general intelligence? Not at all. First of all, this is a language model. It's not AI overall. So this is more of a more efficient version of ChatGPT than anything new that you would call it. And the third one is, what happens to the conversation about responsible AI and ethical AI? There is a risk that because of this mindset that now we are in a new form of an AI race, there'll be less conversation about within US, should we hit a pause button on AI development? Should we do this in an ethical and bias-free way? I think unfortunately it's going to take a back seat because the geopolitical concerns will outweigh the need to be very careful about building responsible and ethical AI. So what about startups and investments? As I said, it's a great time for startups who so far were worried that they can only build application layer on top of this infrastructure. Now they can go back and take advantage of this new algorithmic improvements and can be very small team. In fact, just in the last 1 week, hundreds of startups have taken code like DeepSeek, and others have actually already improved on that, and startups already using it and launching new versions on top of that. Just follow the feed on that. There's, of course, an industry transformation going on. There's something called core AI and applied AI, and core AI is chips, cloud services, and foundation models versus applied AI, where you modify those models and build them for specific applications. There's a dramatic shift that's going to happen away from core AI into applied AI. And this shift in investment will be actually a great thing because most of the companies working in applied AI will be small, nimble thing that are domain experts in agriculture or mining or hospitality and so on. Now they will actually start benefiting from the fruits of AI. So to conclude, there are three major trends that are going to be dominating going forward. One is that tiny AI, you know, AI on the edge, small models are going to append the large models. Second is that we're going to see AI working across data silos. You don't have to think about massive centralization of data and talent and compute to take this forward. And the third is that geopolitically, it's going to become possible to build your so-called supply chain of AI and collaborate with each other, just the way it happens with other sectors of economy. And this decentralization is going to play a big role. So whether DeepSeek is a Sputnik moment or a start of an AI race, I'm not so sure about that. But one thing's very clear, we're moving away from centralization of AI to decentralization of AI. Thank you.